So good morning, everybody, and welcome to the 2022 Net Patient Day. We're delighted that we have such a great attendance. Thank you all for coming. There's a huge appetite to get together after the last 2 years of virtual presentations that we've done. And you know, the last time we were all together like this was 2019, and you know, so much has changed in the world. But and now this year we're actually celebrating our 10th anniversary of Net Patient Network. I know there's a lot of new faces and there's a lot of older faces as well here that have been with us for the 10 years. And you know, it's become a real fixture in the calendar now that that this event is on. And you know, as a patient myself, I know the first time that I was in, you know, got diagnosed and told this rare disease, and you have to worry that, oh, it's cancer, and are we going to live? What's going to happen? Never heard of it, no, nobody with it. And I know in Tommie Gorman's book, he mentions the first get-together of patients in Cork in 2011. And I remember being very lucky to be one of the patients that went to that. And you know, I just had liver surgery, and I remember feeling every bump on the road down to Cork. And it was eye-opening though when I got there, and it went into this room full of patients that had the same disease as me, were on the same journey. And you know, it just really changed my whole perception of the disease. And I, you know, realized that, you know, I can live with this, I can fight it, I can deal with it. And then I remember in 2012, Tommie Gorman again organized a patient event. And I remember going along with a friend of mine, Cullen O'Callaghan, who's since passed away, unfortunately. But Cullen was all set to try and get involved with Tommie in organizing a patient group. And I remember going along on Cullen's coattails, really, and turning up at 2012. And again, it was another really vibrant meeting, and you could feel a sense of community amongst the patients. And so I remember putting my hand up and saying, I'd be happy to get involved in this. But Cullen was the man who was driving this. And so anyway, I ended up coming out as the chairperson of Net Patient Network. And little did I know, Cullen was going to set me up for 10 years of volunteering work. And so it was Cullen's anniversary yesterday. He would have loved to have seen this and what's happening, and the institution, the organization that he was so instrumental in putting together. But I have to say, it's also been a real privilege to be involved in this, and we've seen so many changes along in those 10 years. Like, we've seen the appointment of a national lead for NETS in Professor Dermot O'Toole, the work that Donal O'Shea has done in getting it all set up and getting prepared for this. We've seen the introduction of gallium 68 PET scanning. We're going to see the introduction of PRRT, the establishment of a real centre of excellence in St. Vincent's, supported by CUH and Galway University Hospital. And really, the system has come on in leaps and bounds. And you know, now this event every around November 10th being Net Cancer Day, this event has really become established in the calendar. And you know, we all benefit. We had a great night last night with the dinner, and to get to talk to other patients, it's just so, it's so reaffirming really for us on our journey with this disease. And you know, I think you know, today there's an opportunity to learn a lot about what's happening in the field, and to learn what's happening in Ireland. And then in the afternoon we go into a question and answer session, and that really is where the meat of this event always has been. It's a great interaction. The doctors have you know, make themselves available here for no reward. They come and they answer your questions, and it was a great interaction and a really great sense of community and support between us, the patients, and the clinicians that are here. So I'm looking forward to some really great talks, a really very active question and answer session in the afternoon, and then we'll stay for lunch. We'll have lunch over there at the side of the room, and just mingle and talk to each other and really, you know, we all help each other on our journey. So with that, I'm going to play a video from the Minister for Health, Stephen Geoghegan, who has he couldn't be here, but Donnelly. I got confused with Justin. Justin's, you're moving on there, Justin, to the Minister for Health. Stephen Donnelly has sent in a recorded video, so I'm going to play that now. So
we're having a cabinet reshuffle. I'm proud to speak with you all today on the 10th anniversary of the NET Patient Network. As with so many important events recently, I know it hasn't been possible for the network to meet in person over the last few years, so it's great to see everybody able to meet today face to face. I know that members of the network, both patients and families, have described the patient days as an opportunity to feel involved, an opportunity to feel not alone, to find support with each other and to share your experiences. As you're all aware, the network has been instrumental in driving improvements in neuroendocrine tumour care and outcomes for patients in Ireland. As Minister for Health, I want to really emphasise to all of you my commitment and the government's commitment to enhancing and progressing cancer services in Ireland. Between last year and this year, I allocated an additional €40 million for the ongoing rollout of the National Cancer Strategy. The funding has helped improve the patient experience for all types of cancer. It means that more patients can access better services, leading to what we all want, of course, which is better survival rates. This includes NET, where funding of €859,000 has been used to bring radio-labelled therapy to Ireland for the first time. Next year, we expect to spend around €3.5 million on providing the service to 40 patients, increasing this to 50 to 60 within the next 5 years. Tommie Gorman, who is there with you today, first brought together a group of patients 10 years ago, and he did this to create the Neuroendocrine Tumour Patient Network, to advocate for improved services at a time when it was still necessary to travel far afield to receive treatment. Under Tommie's leadership, and Tommie, thank you for that leadership, and thank you for everything that you've done. Under Tommie's leadership and that of Mark McDonnell, your network has grown from strength to strength. The role that the network has played in advocating for better outcomes for NET patients is a fantastic example of how the patient voice is so important and how advocacy plays such an important role in improving services for patients. The network provides empowerment for patients facing very difficult treatment. It shows the value of advocacy in healthcare. It shows how cooperative engagement between patients and healthcare professionals can lead to improvements for all concerned. Many of the treatments which were only available abroad are now available in St. Vincent's. The NET clinic in St. Vincent's gained international recognition as a NET Centre of Excellence in 2017, and it continues to grow and develop its NET services and expertise. The network has successfully advocated for the introduction of dedicated scanning to diagnose NET, which is now available in St. Vincent's, and for dedicated radio-labelled therapy, which will see the first patient treated by the end of the year. I'd really like to pay tribute to the work of Professor Dermot O'Toole as national lead for NETs. I would also like to thank the committee of the NET Patient Network for all of your organisation, both in making today possible and through many, many years. And can I wish you all the best of luck today and into the future.
So that was a nice address from the Minister for Health, Stephen Donnelly. So with that, I'm going to invite Professor Dermot O'Toole, the National Lead for NETs in Ireland, to come and talk to us a little bit about what's happening in the country at the moment.
Thanks, Mark. Well done. Congratulations. Mark and Tommie, congratulations. But really, congratulations to you all. And I know that Mark mentioned a couple of people who were involved, like Cullen and Mick, of course, and gosh, we have lots of friends who are not with us any longer. And I was chatting to a few of you earlier. I mean, the whole objective is to try to make your journey and the journey for your loved ones, of course, the best possible, and to get as much out of what we're doing here together for as long as we can. That's what it's all about. And I think that your involvement, I mean, I'm talking about the NET Patient Network globally, has been really instrumental in help us bolster the whole structure. If the Minister for Health and recently at Tommie Gorman's lovely book launch, which I was at Trinity, it's lovely because the minister, there were lots of ministers there and former politicians, and but then we had an Taoiseach as well, who's a lovely man, and I got to meet him and spend quite a bit of time chatting to him, and you could see how personal he was and how he got the whole thing. With the health sort of aspect of around Tommie's journey, and he got it for other patients, and some of the other patients met him as well. And I think that, you know, it's Tommie, of course, has been a key figure in getting that, but also a lot of you who've engaged very positively from a small group, you know, you've come very far, I think, in 10 years, which is really good. So it's a great tribute to you. I also love the new logo, by the way. It's very nice, and it's really distinctive. It brings in the zebra. I'm not sure about the orange and red and blue, but you might explain to us exactly how that's designed. It's lovely. How do I go forward, Mark? Oh, yeah. It's very small. It doesn't matter. But it's just a little bit of a feedback. And Mark mentioned it. This was back in 2008. That's when it started, actually. I always think that it's... Minister Donnelly got it wrong. It was 2016 for the Centre of Excellence, but 2017 he said. But anyway, it started back in 2008 in Hawkins House. I think Mary Carney was the Minister for Health at the time. Yep. And we had a meeting.
Darren,
what?
Oh, sorry. It's not true. Look at the next slide. Sorry.
Tom Keane, remember, from Canada, was the cancer guru, came in independently to set up the cancer structures. And with Justin, they set up the Pancreatic Cancer Centre in James's, or James, it was supposed to be in James's, that's right, yeah. Yeah, it was a Freudian slip. And so Tony Hoolan was actually in Hawkins House with us, and he was sort of the leader of that. And Donal O'Shea knew Tony, and we got to meet, and that was the minutes from the first meeting, where we discussed it. Now, the concept was evolved, but it was shelved then because there were other things. And pancreatic cancer was a big, big, big program to get up and running first. But we really started working then, I would say, you know, without a formal structure at that time. I got involved with Donal and Vincent's, and then the sort of movement around getting people sort of central to the figure was really came from that. 2012 then, with... Susan O'Reilly, Irish-Canadian or Canadian-Irish, with a bit of, I think, Scots blood as well. She did a very nice job, and she was involved after Tom Keane, and set up a formal structure to recognise the clinical group looking after patients with neuroendocrine tumours or neuroendocrine neoplasms. And, you know, it seems very, looking back on it now, it seems like it's sort of, yeah, which was, it seemed fairly straightforward. There was a lot of talk, a lot of negotiations. But what was important was, and I just want to pay tribute to them, was that they got that concept. Because there were lots of other, you know, bigger cancer groups that weren't terribly well organized still, not breast cancer or colon cancer, but they were evolving as well in a positive way. So to get something like a rarer thing, you know, to get it up and running, I was a bit surprised, very pleasantly surprised, but in fairness, they got the concept. And that's evolved since, you know, and we'll talk about that very briefly. But just that harks back to, you know, Minister Donnelly on Taoiseach sort of, you know, being aware of it. And I think that's, we're in a positive sort of place, let's say, with that in mind, thankfully. So then, this was 2016. We were... granted a Centre of Excellence accreditation. What does that mean? I'm going to talk to you a little bit about that. What that means is it's a concept that you as patient and as carers or family members, that, you know, what does it really mean to you? Well, I suppose what it really means is that there's a structure of dedicated people there to trying to help you on your journey. I mean, that's really what it's about. There are 68 of them worldwide, quite a few in Europe, as you can see. There's a couple, three in Australia. Canada is trying to apply for approval now. There's a few in the States as well. Not too many in the States because it's a complex structure over there. But we were there, and this is sort of where we are now in 2022. And we've got this is the NET team. And this is sort of, looks like a lot of people, and there are a lot of people. Now, obviously, these people are not every day dealing with patients who've just, you know, got neuroendocrine tumors. But, you know, we have more and more people involved, and this is sort of an interaction between lots of different clinicians, coordinators, like Lisa, who's our coordinator, and for multidisciplinary team meetings, etc. So we get together, and for different parts of the program, we might have to talk to a radiologist or a nuclear medicine physician. We might have to talk to, you know, the oncologist. Now we have a half-time dedicated oncologist in Vincent's. Like, that's amazing. So 50% of this patient's time is allotted to neuroendocrine tumor patients. So, and we've got a go-to person for that, Mark Doherty. I'm not sure Mark is here, but are you here, Mark? I think you met him last year, but anyhow. And so you know, that's a great step forward. And of course, we work in harmony with our colleagues in Cork. We've got Derek and Christor, the surgeon and the oncologist, and they have multidisciplinary team meetings that are part of the general GI oncology group, where they will discuss. So they may have a smaller number of patients overall, but still a very dedicated group. And then also Marcia Bell, who's an endocrinologist in Galway, and Greg Leonard, who's an oncologist. And I must say, we've got great dealings with them as well. And patients sometimes with multiple endocrine neoplasia or genetic disorders, some of the groups in both Cork and Galway. Limerick might feed, for example, to Cork, and they might feed to us as well. It depends. But very good interaction. That interaction is going to grow and enhance over time. We have secondary partners as well. So sometimes we have to look at people for genetics, people who've got lung neuroendocrine tumors, and some of you here may be part of that group. So we have good interactions now with the cardiothoracic surgeons. And they are more willing now to sort of say, look at somebody with potential neuroendocrine tumor of the lung. Let's see what, Ristéard might say, or Greg Leonard, or whoever. So they can start to look now and focus on the NET teams that are well flagged, I think, within the group. this is what we do on a weekly basis. This is the neuroendocrine tumor board, or the multidisciplinary team meeting. And there is it's not just ad hoc. I mean, and it's a complex story. So, you know, you come in for your scan, let's say tomorrow, and you get bloods, you might get urines done if you have got, if you need to measure urines. And then it goes through a process. So it has to be revised. We have the MDT meetings every 2 weeks. That'll probably increase, because if we're starting to do PORT, then we'll have to have dedicated meetings to discuss patients for PORT. We have get together, we agree on decisions then, and then all of the different treatments that might be surgery. You might have treatment for the liver, special treatment for the liver. There might be PORT, there might be somatostatin analogs on its own. Somebody might have had a tumor of the appendix, for example, and they're completely, there's no adverse features. A young patient, for example, quite frequently we see those, we'd review it by our pathologist, and then we sort of say, there's no need for any further treatment. So we can see that young patient with their parents, reassure them that that's fine, that should never come back. So that's part and parcel of it as well. We also have patients then here on the left-hand side, if they've got very aggressive, and we do have really aggressive forms of neuroendocrine tumor disease, neuroendocrine cancer, and if they have the aggressive path, we try to fast track those patients really fast to oncology service. Okay, that'll be Mark, for example, with us, or it'd be Greg Leonard in Galway, or Derek Power, for example, in Cork, or indeed other oncologists. So many of the other oncologists are absolutely top class in delivering chemotherapy treatment for those type of patients. The important thing is that we've had the discussion, we can sort of say, yes, this merits this type of treatment. So that's what we get up to at those meetings. This is just a breakdown of for our group, and it's pretty similar, I would say, in Cork and Galway. I don't have the figures from there to show you, but we can see that referrals for us are, this is Hussein, who, by the way, I meant to say that on that slide. So apart from having a half-time oncologist now dedicated to NET in our group, Dr. Hussein Al-Miamar, can you stand up for a second, Hussein, and just wave there? So this is the first full-time NET physician appointed in Ireland this year. So again, this was a big win, and it's really thanks to the National Cancer Control Program, and it was represented obviously by the lead here, Ristéard, who will speak after me. But again, talk about people getting it. This is really important because, you know, we need to have, so we have Donal, we have Rachel, we have people that you know, for example, in our group. You've got Derek and Christor and Marcia and Greg, but they're doing so many other things, just like I'm doing other things as well. So as we grow from strength to strength, we have more and more dedicated people within the group, and it's really, really important. Anyhow, referrals from outside Dublin here about 54% of the time, who's saying there's an audit in 2020, still more or less the same. And we can see that most of them are the digestive tract tumours. They're about 73%, 70%, right? Three quarters, let's say. And so that means that they're involving the small bowel or the pancreas or the stomach or the colon or the rectum. And the others then are varied, mixed, and they might be lung, etc. And then there's just a few things on grades. What about numbers then? Again, this is David White. So David, in fact, is one of our data managers. So data will be put in by David every week. He comes to the MDT. He will put down the outcomes and involved in the communication of the results as well. So in 2021, this was the audit that we did. There was 171. Numbers were down probably a little bit because of COVID, I would say. You can see in 2020, we only had 77 new patients. So you can see that there was a knock on new patients as well during COVID, and that's reflected in many of the cancer surveys, I would say. Would that be correct, Ristéard? But again, good numbers, because we went from about 90 new patients when we started in 2016 now to almost 200 per year. And we're probably projected to be about 200 new patients per year within our centre. Now, that doesn't include Greg and Eric. So there are far more patients throughout the Isle of Ireland. What we try to do as well is to try to fast track as much as we can. So this is work, of course, by Lisa, but everybody, you know, so Justin might get, for example, referred a patient with some disease in the liver as the surgeon for an opinion. The minute he sees that that's a neuroendocrine tumor patient, that'll be fast tracked to our group. And we try to get from referral letters to the time to the multidisciplinary meeting. We try to get that within as short a time frame as possible. And we try to do it within a month. Now, it's not always possible for every patient, but the vast, vast, vast majority of patients are fast-tracked within 2 weeks, which is good. And I think for cancer services, if you're watching the Channel 4 news during the week, you know, you can see that, you know, they have sort of 7 weeks, 42 days for a GP referral with a cancer. And, you know, we always think faraway hills are greener, but in fact, they're not always that green either. So, I mean, I don't want the wheels to come off this either, especially with capacity issues. And that is a problem, as we'll see later on when we talk about gallium PET CT. But we're not doing too badly. Patient flow, then, just very briefly, we have the referrals coming in, and there's a pathway that we go through, a dedicated pathway. We have the MDT, or that specific meeting, to decide, to review all of the data, to decide what the treatment plan would be. And then, of course, we have the follow-up, and that's very important. And a lot of you will be just on surveillance follow-ups, etc. We try to do that in as timely a way as possible. And to see you quickly after your scans as well. It's not always possible, but we try to. And our clinic is busier and busier as well. I think we can all attest to that. We're a very busy clinic yesterday. We didn't have an MDT yesterday morning, but in Vincent yesterday, very busy clinic. And that's good, of course. But busyness brings other issues as well, of course. So this is the multidisciplinary team meeting, and we see about 30 to 35 patients, which is a decent number, actually, for any of the cancer services, I would say. This is just to show you that the outcome is sort of, you know, that's through a database, and that's David, who is not here today, but David, we should have thought about inviting David, because it's nice for him to see the real world of what's going on. But anyway, that just taken out all of the stuff, obviously, so there's no, but you know, that's an outcome, let's say, and there's a, for this patient then, and the follow-up recommendation is a gallium PET CT in 6 months' time for that individual patient. So it could be something else, it could be surgery, or just to show you. We had, just 2 weeks ago, we had international auditors came to visit St. Vincent's for a full day. And what they did was they looked through our figures for the year of 2021. So we had to show them all of our figures, all of the numbers. They looked at quality data, they looked at safety, they looked at outcomes, and they randomly picked a number of patient files. Of course, it's anonymized, but they're given permission to do that. So they went through a patient file, so it could be my file, for example, if I had a midgut neuroendocrine tumor or a pancreas, and they went through it in fine detail to see, were we doing more or less what should be internationally recommended? So that's what an audit is, okay? And the certification process to become a center of excellence, I mean, center of excellence, you could call it center of mediocrity, it's, you know, doesn't matter, but the idea is that we're following guidelines that are established throughout the world, and we're adhering to that. You know, if you get above 90%, you should be pretty good in most things. And I won't go through that, but basically, that's a long list of just summarize some of the things. But it includes lots of things, not just you know, how you see patients. And an interesting one, I would just say that's come on board recently, is also what the feedback from the patients has been. So the Neuroendocrine Tumor Society group in Europe called the ENETS, they have devised a patient questionnaire that's online now. And for those of you who come to see us in the last 2 months, we've started to implement that because Ireland was a little bit slow to get up on that. So it's basically you just scan through your phone and you just have a questionnaire. And we've been doing it for about 2 months, but the number of patients are actually, you guys weren't filling out the questionnaires very well. So that's important that you do your bit. And not just when things are not going right, when things are going things are going right is important because we're actually audited on that as well. So the patient satisfaction questionnaire, how you interact, and we can see about getting that rolled out in Cork and Galway as well. But it's part of the ENET Centre of Excellence group, so it's an interesting one. So what about gallium PET CT? I said I'd say a few words about that. So we have gallium PET CT. There are two gallium generators in Ireland, one in Vincent's and one in St James's Hospital. Now, first of all, I don't know of any patients who have gone abroad recently for gallium. We had to send patients away for it before. So it is, of course, a positive that we have it, but it's a cumbersome tracer to develop. There's a lot of radioactivity around it, and you need a lot of staff to do it. We can only basically do, on any given day, 4 per day. And we have capacity issues in St. Vincent's because we don't have enough staff in the PET CT scan group. And it's really, really hard. I mentioned that earlier. It's really hard now to recruit staff in this area, radiographers, etc. And we're trying to get even nurses dedicated to help in delivering the PRT service. That was one of our major stumbling blocks, trying to recruit people into a job, a well-paid job. So, you know, I'm a little bit nervous about capacity in the healthcare system overall. A lot of nurses in endoscopy, where I work in James's recently, have actually left. They've gone to live in the Midlands or in the Northwest, where they could afford housing with young families, etc. So there are awful things, I think, you know, awful. I'm not saying awful. I don't want to make it sound too bad. But there are things outside of our real control. So even though there's a lot of money in the system, if you can't have the staff there, you really run into capacity. So there is a proposal at play for automatic dispensing of the product, of the gallium 68, which is a radioactive substance that has to be manufactured and just manipulated. And if you can do that in an automated way, you can get more patients through. Oops. So that's one thing. And then, of course, recruitment of additional staff. If tomorrow we could wave a magic wand and say, let's have a gallium generator in Cork, I'd be delighted. And I think that our patients in Dublin wouldn't mind going to Cork for gallium. It's expensive, though. The setup process is expensive. And there's also gallium PET-CT that's done for patients with prostate cancer using a different radioisotope. And there might be competition around that. But it's not really affecting us at the moment in Vincent's. It really is a capacity thing. How to get over that? We've had numerous meetings, and we've had direct meetings with Professor O'Leary, who's really been trying to get this and trying to really see how, in fact, we can prize open better those staffing issues, really, in Vincent's. So just a future direction in PRT in Ireland. So over the past 3 years, we've been trying to get this on board, maybe even a little bit longer, just to say that this has been backed and funded, thankfully, through the National Cancer Control Programme. There's been staffing investments, structural changes. The building is almost complete. I don't think we thought we'd be ready for Q3 of this year. We won't be ready for Q4. I'd say it'll be the start of next year. To be honest with you, I don't want to tell you lies about that. Two inpatient rooms and transform into a 4 outpatient delivery suite for patients, basically, who would be, so we could have patients, no matter where you come from in Ireland, that you'd be able to stay overnight. I won't go through this, but there's a good bit of net research as well, and it's led by Donal and also by Hussein. There are quite a few projects up and running at the moment. One on nutrition with Peter Mac Centre in Australia. So there's good collaboration between the recognised Centre of Excellence, clinical trial application, and other research projects as well. Just to acknowledge the entire team, Lisa with Jenny. Jenny Cross is our NDT coordinator. She's an amazing, she's a great star of ours. David White, as I mentioned. Hussein, a new NET physician. Dara is our fellow, great guy, gastroenterology fellow, but is doing NET for this year. And all, of course, our NET colleagues and within the hospital are very good to us, and our colleagues, of course, in Cork and Galway. The St. Vincent's executives have also been very supportive for us. and the National Cancer Control Programme and our international partners have been so good to us to help us with our just a second opinion. Obviously for the PRT, we send mostly to Uppsala, but there are other places like in the UK. Just to acknowledge Uppsala has been a great partner for years, and we had Professor Ogberg, who was the former lead of that. He was one of the auditors over, and I thanked him formally. Just also to say to the Treatment Abroad Scheme, who supported our group for so long, and many other groups as well, largely represented by Catherine, who should be here. She is here. I've seen her. She always wants to stay down out of the limelight. Catherine, thank you so much, and to your group, because not only have you done so much, but you're also very kindly agreed to continue, obviously, the Treatment Abroad. As we set up the PRT and get it running, we'll be able to have that in parallel, because we can't just go from time zero to take all of the capacity. So there will be a phasing in component to that. We've got to do it safely. So for patients, I would anticipate for patients who've already started PRT, they would continue abroad. And for fit, young and healthy people who are okay to go abroad, we'd probably do it that way. But we've got to come up with a program for that. We're meeting with Derek and with Greg over the next few weeks to talk about how we actually roll it on. That's it.
So thanks so much, Dermot, for that, you know, great overview of what's happening. And I think it was very worthwhile saying about the PRT. Like, we, as patients, we're all, you know, really eager to see that happening in Ireland, because, you know, there are patients that really worry about travelling, and you know, but it's also great to know that that will continue, the avenue through Catherine will continue to have access to that abroad while the system comes up to speed in Ireland. So thank you. Now I want to invite Professor Ristéard Laoide from the National Director of the NCCP to talk to us about the view of NETs in Ireland from the NCCP.
Morning, everyone. Míle boi, chas a sostan cuire, Mark. Many thanks, Mark, and Tommie, and the whole Neuroendocrine Patient Network for inviting me here this morning. Congratulations on your 10th anniversary. I think you're an exemplar, actually, as a group for the rest of cancer services in this country, the way you have come together as a patient group, the way you've worked with clinicians that work in the hospitals in Dublin, Cork and Galway, the way you've worked with the health services more generally, including the NCCP. And I think the fruits of that are seen in the advances that have taken place in the last 10 years. I've said that to Mark when I met him recently at the Trinity at Tommie's book launch. It's been done in a really exceptional way, in a purposeful, driven way, but not in an aggressive way, in a collaborative way. And I think that's an exemplar for the rest of our services, because there are lots of other groups within the health services, obviously the patient groups and advocacy groups dealing with cancer, but I would recommend them to look at what you have done as a group, because it's been great. I'm going to talk just a little briefly about Dermot has given a discussion on the neuroendocrine tumours, and I'm just going to talk about how it sits within the NCCP as a whole, and just a little bit about the NCCP. Some of you may not be familiar with it. Is this the way we go? Sorry, that is ringing a bell at me. That's all right. Which button is it? Okay. So I'll just talk briefly about the NCCP, the current developments in cancer services generally, and then just focus a little bit on the neuroendocrine tumours. Just to say, we're conscious, I suppose, the neuroendocrine, Dermot has given some of the figures for the neuroendocrine tumours, but in Ireland about 26,000 people a year will develop cancer, and that's expected to double by 2040. So there's a large group of patients developing cancer in this country. This doesn't include the non-melanoma skin cancers, which are a very large group as well. So there's a significant number of patients, I suppose, we are dealing with. We understand that the cancer system has been under significant stress through COVID. So the stresses are the demographic increase in cancer. In other words, the number of patients developing cancers is increasing because the population is getting older and the population is increasing. We've had the impact of the infection prevention and control measures on how cancer is delivered. So that's put a stress on the services. We recognise that there has been some delayed diagnosis in this because of patients coming later for a variety of reasons during the COVID phase, and that leads to greater complexity and obviously a greater stress on the delivery of cancer services. There is limited cancer infrastructure in this country, and I think one of the key areas that I've been trying to focus on generally in cancer is the access to diagnostics, because that's just not true for neuroendocrine tumours and your gallium scanning. It's true of a wide variety of cancers in this country. Our capacity in diagnostics is not sufficient. And then staffing, recruitment and retention. And that's, again, not a specific issue for nurses, for PRRT. It's a general issue in this country, and it is much wider than, I suppose, the medical space, as Dermot has mentioned, the cost of living, the which is a key one, really, the kind of, I suppose, we need to develop measures to retain people within our services, the career pathways. We've done that somewhat in nurses, but it's less well developed in radiation therapy and radiography. So these are areas we have to look at as a country and how we keep our staff. So generally, the cancer system is under a lot of pressure in this country, and you're aware of that. So the NCCP itself, just to say what it is, I mean, National Cancer Control Programme. When I say control in it, control is a bad word in my head. I don't want to control. It sounds slightly Stalinist. But actually what we're trying to control is cancer, not anything else. So it's cancer control is what we want to do. So it's a national programme in this country, and its programme means that it's done, rolled out on a programmatic model which looks at a particular problem and tries to deal with it. So it's a national cancer control programme. So this was, the NCCP was launched in 2007, and this came on the back of a second national cancer strategy on which I had the privilege to sit, and Tom Keane was the first national director that was recruited at the time. And our role is across the whole cancer patient pathway. So prevention of cancer is really important to us, and for example, in areas like lung cancer, we have been very busy this year. So it starts with that. Then obviously the treatment of cancer, which is a large element, and that's broad. It involves radiation oncology, surgical oncology, medical oncology, diagnostics, lots of areas. So, and finally, it's to increase the survival and quality of life for those who develop cancer. That was a particular focus of our last cancer strategy, which looked at survival and quality of life after developing cancer. So, and by converting the knowledge gained through research, surveillance and outcome evaluation, we develop strategies and actions to do that for the country. So, the national cancer strategies are, I suppose, in some ways our Bible, because the national cancer strategies, there have been three of them. The last one is 2017 to 2026. And that, as I say, had a significant stress on prevention and survivorship. But these strategies have been developed really by, in combination with patient advocacy groups, the medical professions, the nursing professions, all the groups that are involved in cancer. And the plan is brought to government and it's endorsed by government. So it's the plan that we use to drive what we do in developing our strategies and our actions. So if we look at the National Cancer Strategy, that's the latest version of it, and as Minister Donnelly rightly pointed out, you can see that there was, the amount of investment in the cancer strategy initially was small. It was initially hoped that there would be the significant funding every year for the cancer strategy, but it didn't happen in 2016, 17, 18, 19. But in 2020, in 2021, there was a significant rise, as you can see here, and we got 20 million in 2021 and 2022 for the development of cancer strategies in this country. 2023 isn't out yet, so I can't tell you about that. But and that's under Minister Donnelly's watch. So annually, we spend about 90 million a year through the NCCP. That's embedded money in the services that are ongoing. The new funding, the 20 million per year which we get, it allows us to develop new services, and that's where things like gallium scaling and PRRT come in. Obviously, the 20 million has to be spread over a lot of services, the whole pathway from prevention to survival. So while it sounds a significant amount of money, that we have to be quite judicious in how it's spent and to get the best value for the taxpayer and for the patients. So we had 12 million in pandemic funding in 2021, which didn't repeat in 2022. And that was really around the stresses in the services and trying to keep the services functioning at that time. A significant development in 2021 was also an additional 50 million, which was put in by the Department of Health for new drugs. Now, again, that's for all drugs, but there was a significant amount of it for oncology drugs. So if we look at the outcome, I suppose, in posts, in 2021, we funded 205 additional posts in the cancer services in 2021 and over 200 in 2022. And these are additional posts on top of the posts that are currently in the services. So we look at there. We try to do new developments, obviously, with the funding, and there's a wide range of them across involving patient pathways, governance, enablers, specific patient groups, and new treatments. And I suppose what's relevant today is the PRRT, which was it was decided by the National Cancer Control Programme that we should develop that in 2021, and we began with some funding, and through the leadership of Dermot and his colleagues in St. Vincent's Hospital, we're hoping that would be rolled out, as he says. I heard Q4 this year, but he's tempering my optimism now. But so that's what we've told. But there are obviously other developments that you possibly wouldn't be familiar, like CAR-T, which is a particular development for blood cancers, particularly in children. There's SABR, which is a new form of radiation and therapy, which is much shorter treatment for patients, and very focused therapy, and that's been rolled out in St. Luke's and will be rolled out in Cork and Galway. And, you know, there are lots of other areas, molecular diagnostics or whatever, that we've tried to develop in the NCCP. So I suppose important issues, just to, I suppose you're aware of in the broader picture as well, is the regional health areas. These are government policy. They're part of the Sláinte Care project under the Department of Health, and they're laying out how services will be developed in the country. And there are six regional health areas, as you can see here, there's some changes in the South and in the Ireland East hospital groups. But as I say, we're going to work with these regional health areas because the idea is that they would have significant autonomy within these areas and that would include cancer services. But obviously there are important central evidence, central elements, the organisation of our cancer services particularly, and which would include the neuroendocrine tumours, which the NCCP will be working on with the Department of Health on how we retain what's good in that and what's good about delegation as well. So So centralisation has been an important element in cancer services, not for the sake of making patients travel, but having sufficient volume of patients going through a unit for sufficient expertise. And I know that's what happened with the neuroendocrine tumour and the development of the Centre of Excellence at St. Vincent's, having a significant number of patients so that you have the significant number of specialists, etc., to deliver the service. It's happened in other areas, pancreas, Dermot mentioned neuroendocrine tumour, lung, for example. We have four surgical centres for lung in this country, Cork, Galway, and Beaumont and the Mater. And then hemato-oncology is another area we're looking at centralisation. But kind of fitting in with Sláinte Care and with the regional health areas, we want to link the services together as a network in this country. And that's critical from my standpoint as National Director of the NCCP. The networking is particularly important, because we have a decentralisation of national specialties in this country, for example. So we don't have a Memorial Sloan Kettering Hospital in this country. We're not likely to have it in the next 10 years. I'm going to the politics, but it's something that I can't see happening in the next 10 years. Sometimes I've got to hold my tongue. So we do have national specialties. So, for example, you have the GTD, which is an obstetric specialty in Cork. You've got neuro-oncology in Beaumont. You've got neuroendocrine tumour in Vincent's. You've got bone marrow transplantation in James's. So we have these developed the centres of excellence, but they're not all in the one place. And that's the way it is. We have a distributed network of these things. But it makes it important then that we have network in this country, because we want the care, whether it's diagnostics, survivorship, community care, along the Sláinte Care model, so people get whatever they need closest to their home. And Dermot again mentioned medical oncology. So if you have a national MDT in Vincent's for NET, it doesn't mean that the medical oncology needs to take place there. It can take place in other centres. But the important thing is that they're all networked together, so everyone gets the same standard of treatment, no matter where they are in this country, whether it's in Belmullet or Bantry or Malin Head, that everyone in this country is connected into the system, which requires them to go centrally for something, but hopefully for most of their treatment nearest to their centre locally. So there are two components, and they're not opposing: centralisation and networking. So we're looking at that and the development of that. And so we can see we're going to have regional cancer services. Most of them have just one cancer centre in their network. Some, for example, Area A, which is the North Dublin area extending north, has Beaumont and the Mater. The South East has Vincent and Waterford. The South West has just Cork. Limerick is on its own. So they have different number of cancer centres. But we want those cancer centres to work with their Model 2 and 3 hospitals, so that these can be used in delivery of services also. And not only the Model 2 and 3 hospital, but also we have community centres, we have prevention, as I say, all the other areas of cancer care. We want the whole thing to be networked so that we would have a cancer director in each region that would be responsible for prevention right through to quality of care after cancer treatment, and that the whole thing would be networked. Sometimes we need tumour networks as well, and NET is one of the examples of that. That we need to have it, because it's a small volume, a number of cases, then we need to have a network which brings the expertise together nationally. So accreditation is a tool we're hoping to use for that, and because that raises the quality of cancer centres nationally, regardless of their role in the provision of cancer care. And it supports our benchmarking of what we do with what happens internationally. And the eNet Centre of Excellence is an example of that. So we're promoting accreditation. More generally for cancer, we're looking at two forms of accreditation at the moment. One is I don't want to go into the details, but OECI and ECC are two models of accreditation. We're going to see what suits Ireland best. Maybe it's a combination of both of those. But the idea is that, again, the same thing, that wherever you are in the country, you're getting the same cancer care, and there's no barrier to access wherever you are in the country. So as regards neuroendocrine tumour, I've spoken, I suppose, of some of the issues there. Dermot has mentioned the NET Centre at St Vincent's Hospital, and just to congratulate Dermot and all the team again on the work and getting the accreditation for that. I'm going to have a focus, and I know it's good to see the collaboration between the different centres, but we need to strengthen that network between the centres in Cork, Galway and Dublin. The repatriation of PRRT has been mentioned, and then we want to we've seen it here, the link between your network and the NET services to strengthen that. So I think the importance of the network is that we get collaboration and collective development of the services. Dermot mentioned gallium. Just to say, the NCCP has agreed to fund the automatic dispenser, so we're going to do that. I mean, it's about optimising the service in Vincent's and looking at how we develop the services further in this country. So there's no, as I say in these things, there's nothing off the table, but it's just to make sure we get the right model for the country, and we're going to look at that with everyone. And we need to do that, as I say, as a network. The shared MDM already exists, and we have an accredited centre, but I think we'd be looking at cancer generally at having networks accredited as well. So the benefits to this are obvious: to get the best available diagnostics wherever it is, the best available treatment wherever it is, and planning, and to get that care coordinated. I, again, and this isn't related to NET, I hasten to add, because fair be for me to criticise, but I, when I go around to some of the centres, they say, we want to be a national centre for X in hospital Y. And I say, well, if you want to be a national centre in hospital Y for this disease, I want to know how you're going to deal with that woman in Belmullet. That's the key for me. The national centre needs to have the plan for the patients wherever they are, not building up their unit centrally. It's how you get the patient easily in and easily back out again to get the treatment they require. So again, consistency of care regardless of location, and appropriate care provided closer to home where possible. So míle buíochas agus ar scá céile a bhar na daoine, as they say, sin fog will networks an a chácta. And just to say my apologies in advance, I have to go to Mayo in the next short while to a family event, so I won't be able to stay for the rest of the morning. So congratulations to you all on your 10th anniversary, and it's fantastic to see it. Thanks very much.
So thanks so much to Ristéard, and we appreciate you coming this morning and giving us that outline of what the cancer services in Ireland are. And I do think it's worth saying that Ristéard himself has been instrumental in getting PRRT into Ireland, has been a great supporter of us as NET Patient Network along the years in his prior role in St Vincent's. So, really a great supporter of us, and thank you. So now I'd like to... So now I'd like to invite Lisa Cullen. I'm getting bad with names this morning. So invite Lisa Cullen, the NET nurse specialist in St. Vincent's, to come and talk to us a little bit about the NET terminology and how we can better understand those patients.
Well, just to say thanks, Mark. Well, I'll thank you in a minute when you get it set up. And it's lovely to look down and see all the familiar faces, and it's nice not to be in a hospital, to be in a hotel. Oh, can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Yeah, okay. So, sorry. So it's just nice to look down and see all the familiar faces and to be in a different environment than the hospital, in a nice hotel, plush hotel. So that's really nice. Can you hear me okay? Yeah. What? No, you can't. I wonder, can I move that up a little bit? Is that better? Yeah, okay, sorry. Well, so you heard that. I know it's just nice to see you all here together and not in hospital. So, there we go, great. So Mark asked me just to talk a little bit about simplifying the language around neuroendocrine tumours. So when we think about the tumours and all the terminology around them, let me go back in. So just when we think about neuroendocrine tumours, the language around them, where they start from, where they originate from, what symptoms you all develop or have, what treatments, classification, so the staging and grading of those tumours. We understand, even for us, that they're hard to decipher, so we know it's a big challenge for you as patients and your family to try and understand. It's just the next one, thank you. So I'm just going to talk about demystifying the terminology, a little bit about the neuroendocrine system, and then to try and simplify the staging and grading. Next one, Mark, please. So first of all, the terminology. So what are these tumours called? Are they called NETs, neuroendocrine tumours, NEC, neuroendocrine carcinomas, NEN, neuroendocrine neoplasms, or simply just carcinoid? Well, the latest recommendation from the World Health Organization is that they're called neuroendocrine neoplasms. And then when we get a further histological diagnosis, we can properly grade and stage them. But just for the talk today, since you're called the NET patient network, I'm going to call, obviously, NET tumours, and hope there's nobody from the World Health Organization here in the audience. So, thanks, Mark. So if we go back to the beginning, over 100 years ago or more, we meet a German pathologist called Siegfried Orbendorfer, who first labelled these carcinoids as carcinoid. So it looked like cancer, but not exactly. And it just had the unique feature of behaving benign, but having a malignant appearance. And if we fast forward to today, 2022, we still find these tumours challenging to treat and to diagnose at an early stage. Next, Mark, thanks. So I spent a long time trying to find an image for neuroendocrine cells or the system, because it was just so complicated. I went through so many of them, just so I'm hoping. I really like this one because I thought it kind of simplified it as much as possible. So to first understand neuroendocrine tumours, we have to look at the neuroendocrine system and its cells, and what does it do? So neuroendocrine system is made up of a network of cells, specialised cells, called neuroendocrine cells, and these cells receive signals from the nervous system. So they have one component that they resemble nerve cells or neurons, and then they also produce hormones like endocrine cells. So that's really where you get the neuroendocrine cell. So if you sit down for lunch today and you begin to eat, the neuroendocrine cells produce hormones to help you digest your food, the hormones, and it also helps coordinate the muscles to move the food in the intestine. So when something goes wrong with your neuroendocrine cells or the system, you begin to develop some of these symptoms. And I know a lot of people here today will know what I'm talking about. So NET tumours are complex because, first of all, they mimic lots of other conditions. They're silent often at the start and take a long time to be diagnosed, as I said. So some of the symptoms, on just the second circle there, diarrhea, sweating, flushing, a lot of you would have experienced those. And then they often, you've been misdiagnosed with more common GI disorders, gastrointestinal disorders, such as irritable bowel syndrome, anxiety, menopause, etc. Okay, so I know that many of you took a long time as well to get your proper NET diagnosis. So just to go through staging and grading as simply as I can, first of all, why is it so important to have a proper stage and grade? Well, first of all, it tells us what appropriate treatment for you. It also helps with prognosis, and it also helps us determine what kind of follow-up would be appropriate for you. So if you just look on the box on the left, the red box, so that's staging. So if you kind of think of staging as all your diagnostic tests, your scans, that's how we come to the stage. And it's a numerical staging, 1 to 4, but we use the TNM system, the classification system. So T stands for tumour, N for node, and M for metastasis. So tumour tells us the size of your tumour, and we measure tumours in centimetres, 1 centimetre being a size width of a pen or pencil that you probably have there, and the location, so where it starts, your primary tumour, so whether that be in the small bowel, your pancreas, lung, etc. Nodes then are lymph nodes, so it tells us whether there's any tumour in your lymph nodes, and we look at the lymph nodes closest to your tumour and then further away. Then mets, whether it's gone from your original primary and spread to other organs such as your liver, bone, etc. Okay, just the next one, Mark, sorry. And just to show you, it's a little bit complicated, so I just want you to look on the top line. And this is for GI NETs, so gastrointestinal NETs, because unfortunately lots of different NETs or tumours are slightly different staging. So stage 1 is the same as a T1N0M0. So that would be T1 stands for that your tumour is less than 1 centimetre. It has not spread to any nodes and it has not gone any further than that. So just stage 1, T1N0M0. Okay, and just... So then the grading, I like to think it's kind of the pathologist's area. So when he has a tissue, when they have a tissue sample, they look at it under the microscope and they grade it from 1 to 3. They look at the mitotic count, which is how fast the cells are dividing. The Ki-67, which I know a lot of you have asked me about before, which is a protein that is produced once the cells start to divide. And then the differentiation of a tumour is how close the tumour looks like to healthy cells. And that's well moderately differentiate, or moderately and poorly. And as I said, grading is different for different NET tumours depending on the site. Next one, please. So just put this up. Just as I said, I know a lot of you had asked me about your case I-67. So if you look at the top left-hand corner, we see just about 6 or 7 tiny little brown dots. And that's the Ki-67 on that tissue sample. So this is a really low Ki-67, a very well differentiated tumour. All the cells are healthy, except you can just see a couple of them are dividing. And then if you look on the very last one on the bottom right, you can see that the whole sample there is taken over by little tiny brown dots, and that's the Ki-67, so that's a poorly differentiated NET tumour. So in summary, I hope I didn't go too fast, but that was just a brief talk on demystifying some of the areas of neuroendocrine tumour. I just want to thank Mark very much for asking me to speak, and it's great to be able to celebrate this day with you 10 years on. Sorry about that.
So Thanks so much, Lisa. And, you know, those of you who interacted with Lisa know, you know, the wonderful job she does and keeping everything going and working for us. I just want to also thank our sponsors today, which is AAA, a Novartis company, Ipsen, and Pfizer. They've all contributed to make the day happen. AAA are producing lutetium treatment, which is in PRT. Novartis does the monthly injection that we get. Ipsen also do a monthly injection. And Pfizer have no drugs involved in our disease area, but yet they wanted to contribute and help us get today to make it happen. So with that, I want to invite Professor Donal O'Shea. And Donal is one of the instigators of making the system in Ireland happen and be available to us. And I also want to thank him because he had other appointment today in the Endocrine Society meeting and he forgot that to come and be with us today. So thanks so much, Donal.
That's a lovely slide, the happy 10th anniversary. I'm happy for that to stay up while I speak. And you may have to have an AGM to look at your, become a NEN patient network. I'll be a NEN patient, NEN work. So 10th anniversary of this, I've been here for most of them, always clashes with the Autumn Internationals. I remember running away to see Italy play South Africa in 2016. And Italy beat South Africa with my brother coaching them. Great day. They didn't go well after that, but anyway, that's not neither here nor there. 10th anniversary of this, it's actually the 30th anniversary of me working with Justin. I remember going to London as a nervous SHO in 1992. John Major was just about to be surprisingly re-elected. And I was nervous and on call, and I went in to the doctor's res, and there was somebody read the newspaper, and I said something, and the newspaper came down, and it was Justin. And I said, oh, I'm a little bit nervous, and he said, it'll be grand. It'll take a few months, but it'll work out. So that's 30 years working closely together in NET, in obesity, and the final 10 years of my career will be without Justin, but I've enjoyed it very much, thank you. Living with NETs, right, broad title. Like Lisa, I will be the second speaker to stick to time and get us back on track. There is no secret to living with a chronic long-term condition, which is what this is for most people. You have to do the basics, and the basics are around, you know, our lifestyle choices. They're not made easy by the society we live in, to have a healthy diet and to be physically active. But they're the things you have to do. The better you eat, the more you walk, then you will be generally healthy. It's the headpiece. With a chronic long-term condition, that's the difficult piece. And if I ever sit with an engineer, I was at a funeral about 3-4 years ago, and this kind of a semi-sister-in-law, her father had died, and her father was an engineer, and she was doing kind of the tribute at the end, and she said, and then he came across a problem he couldn't fix. And for an engineer, that's a problem, because engineers need things fixed. So his son had been killed in a wall, fell down on a building site in Australia, and his son had died, and life was never the same. So engineers need solutions. Engineers need solutions, so a long-term management thing is a problem. So it is about your head. So I remember Brian Cox, he's a physicist, and he walked in to the Young Scientist competition to open it. And he spoke to a whole group of transition year age, kind of 12 to 16 probably. And he said, I just want you to think about this for a minute. You know, we understand the universe. we understand the multiple universes. So we used to think there was one universe. We now know there are multiple universes. And he said, as far as we are aware, this little tiny speck called planet Earth is the only place consistent with life and living. He said, in all the universes, this is the only place where there is life. And as humans, we have arrived at a point where we can think about that, reflect on it, and influence it. And he said, isn't that mad? Right? It's completely mad. It's also probably unlikely when you think about it. So out in one of those others, metaverses or universes, there must be something else going on. But anyway, we are the only place in the entire universe that we're aware of that has life. And we have reached the point where we can think about it, reflect on it, and influence it. So I was driving past Terranure College, mud school I went to. The three pillars of education in that school were community, service, and reflection. This is the community. So, you know, if you're a work family, you have your family, and then if you're in a your social circle, and then this is a specific other community. The service that you're doing is delivering better care for those who are about to be diagnosed with NETs, and you'd be saying, oh, you used to have to go abroad for that, and they won't know any different. And I think the reflection piece is really important, and an over-focus on stage and grade, and we see people whose thinking is dominated by the stage and grade, and an ability to just step back and reflect on the bigger picture, that we're in the overall context of things, lucky to have the opportunity we have. We may not like all of the, if you like, the baggage we have that's with it, but the big picture is worth reflecting on. And this group here, Ristéard mentioned it, have had a bigger effect in the overall scheme of things. So the NET service was developing beautifully across the last 10 years. And I was going, why are we having so much trouble getting obesity services funded and getting obesity services off the ground? And I was thinking about it and I said, we don't have a patient voice. So in 2017, we got a patient network, Patient Voice Irish Coalition, people living with obesity, to form and to start advocating and lobbying in exactly the same way as you have done. And this year, Minister Donnelly announced the full funding of our obesity model of care, 19 million a year, to do 1,200 obesity operations a year, and change the lives of people living with obesity. So thank you for that. The blueprint from the NET Patient Network is what has informed the development of the obesity network treatment. Isn't that mad? Thank you.
Thanks, Donal, and we're getting back on track time-wise. So with that now, I'd like to ask Mr. Justin Geoghegan, the pancreatic surgeon from St. Vincent's, to come up and talk to us about the role of surgery nets. And I hope he doesn't mind, but he's been involved from day one with us and supporting us and is retiring this year. So.
Mark, thanks very much for the invitation. Since you appointed me as Minister for Health, I've decided to editorialise the title a little bit and just compress it down a bit. So I'm going to talk mainly about surgery for pancreatic neuroendocrine tumours, but of course a lot of it generalises to all the different tumour groups, so you'll apologise for me in taking that liberty, but that's what you get to do in your minister. down. Okay, so we think that the incidence of NETs is increasing. I think what's happening is it's becoming easier to detect them. There's a greater awareness. Pancreatic NETs are a significant chunk of those gastroenteropancreatic NETs, the GEP NETs. What a horrible little acronym. Anyway, we have to deal with that one. But they do form a significant chunk of the workload that we have to deal with. There's probably only about one per 100,000 persons per year, so they're still unusual tumours. But there's so much crossover between the different types of NET that they do belong together, and the treatment of one informs the treatments of the other types. Now, I will try to stay on time too, because some of the stuff I'm talking about will have been mentioned already. We've talked about the MDT and the importance of that as a kind of decision-making tool. And there's this whole range of treatments which we have to consider. And actually, the MDT is a tremendously powerful tool for sorting through that and picking the right treatment, and picking particularly the right sequence of treatments, because many of you will already understand and realize and have experienced sequencing of different treatments. And getting that right is terribly important. And sometimes the way we talk about the NET MDT, it feels a bit like the papal conclave. I mean, the room isn't quite as nice, but you know, it's all sort of sanctimonious and all that. And you know, maybe it should be a little bit more like this sometimes. But I think Dermot keeps us all on track. Maybe it is a bit more like that, yeah. but it's still a terribly powerful tool. It's a very important part of the process. It is wonderful that there's such a wide range of treatments, but of course it is so important to get the right one at the right time and get the right sequence. Now, what about the pancreas? I'm sure you all roughly know where it is. It sort of sits in the upper part of the abdomen. It has two big jobs. It makes insulin to control blood sugar, and it makes pancreatic juice to help digest food. So I'm going to start by just describing or just outlining the kind of operations you can do on the pancreas. It's all surgeons are relatively simplistic, you know. They sort of say when you're a hammer, everything looks like a nail, so you just have to pick the right kind of nail that you're going to hit. And here's a sort of diagram of the pancreas. And probably the single most frequently performed pancreatic operation for any kind of tumour is a Whipple operation, where you take out the head of the pancreas. Now, that's a big thing to do, but actually it's been around for an awfully long time. The first Whipple procedure was done by this chap, Walter Kausch, in Berlin. Look at that picture. It's like being on a hunting expedition or something like that. I actually worked for a year in Germany, and you'd be horrified to hear that at one stage my boss set everybody up like this in the middle of a liver operation, kind of, you know, here's the liver that we've taken out. So that sort of mentality maybe just is under the surface for most surgeons. I hope not. The operation was really standardized and made into a realistic procedure by this guy, Whipple, whose name still it carries. And he did about 40 of these procedures in his lifetime. He used to do it in two halves. They do one half of the operation, go home for a couple of weeks while the patient recovered, come back and do the second half. It's a huge undertaking. And for years, it had this terrible, it was associated with very high mortality, up until the sort of mid-60s, maybe even early 70s. And I think one of the great benefits of centralization has been that it's improved safety. And it's probably done that through lots of little incremental steps. But for an operation like this, probably the single biggest thing is that people get better at spotting and treating complications. That's the big, big benefit of centralization. Now, the problem with the pancreas is how do you control the pancreatic juice? When everybody sits down for dinner or for lunch today, I don't know if there's any meat on the menu today, Mark, but if there's meat, your pancreas will be the thing that chops that meat up and makes it and digests it. Your pancreas is stuffed full of very active enzymes that break down proteins very effectively. Your body has to control where they are, right? So when it makes enzymes, they're not active till they hit the juice in your gut. That's why leaks, when you get a leak from the joint between the pancreas and the gut, that's why it's so dangerous, because the pancreatic enzymes get activated when they mix with the gut, and then when they leak, they go everywhere inside your abdominal cavity and cause mayhem. So that's always been the Achilles heel of the Whipple operation. And centralization has certainly made that less of an issue, and when it happens, people are able to manage it better. So Whipple operation accounts for about 65% of the operations on the pancreas. About 30% are distal pancreatectomy. Now, you still get leaks, but if the pancreatic juice leaks, it's not in contact with gut fluid, so it's not activated. So it's a nuisance, but it's not dangerous. It doesn't kill you. Those account for the majority of the operations. Now, there's one operation that's very important for NET tumours, and it comes down to the fact that the tumours are sometimes very indolent with very low sort of aggressiveness. Enucleation is a terribly important procedure, and it's suitable for a lot of small pancreatic neuroendocrine tumours. And you can see this picture. You've got this little sort of pea-sized lesion out in the tail of the pancreas, and it's possible to shell that out like a pea out of a pod. And it comes down to one of the key principles in the management of neuroendocrine tumours. You're looking to preserve function as much as you can. Now, this operation was first done a long time ago as well. It's kind of interesting to reflect that it was done in Toronto in 1926, just 4 years after insulin was isolated in Toronto. So you can imagine there's probably a coffee room conversation between Banting and Best and some of his surgical colleagues about insulin. And they might have put two and two together and realized, jeepers, maybe there's something in the pancreas making insulin. Kind of interesting little quirk of history. There are two operations I'm going to mention very quickly, just to sweep them aside. You can take out the middle third of the pancreas, sort of very occasional procedure, if you've got a small localized tumor. And then sometimes you consider taking out the whole pancreas, and it's one of the operations that has been used in the past and sometimes is still used for patients with MEN lesions. So how do you select what operation to do? And of course, you're familiar with some of this stuff, and Lisa's given you some of the detail. First of all, you need to understand the stage of the tumour. The stage is the anatomical extent of the disease. Is it localised or has it spread? And to work those things out, you need first of all, endoscopic ultrasound to give you local staging. How big is it in the pancreas? How close is it to various blood vessels around there? And you need radiology to show the rest of the body. And again, you're familiar that gallium PET is beginning to occupy a really central role in giving us accurate information about the anatomical extent or stage of the tumor. The next really important thing when you're selecting treatment is understanding the biological personality of the tumor. And Lisa referred to KI67 and all those other things that we need to understand. So, you know, to understand the biological personality, you need a pathologist, and a pathologist needs biopsies. When you put those two together, that's when you begin to understand what is the personality of that tumor. So the grade is the degree of differentiation. You're all aware that some NET tumors are very virtually benign. Some are very nasty. As the tumour becomes nasty, it becomes more and more difficult to actually recognise it as a neuroendocrine cell. It just looks like a horrible, nasty, aggressive cell. That's what degree of differentiation means. So the poorly differentiated tumours have stripped away all the niceties of looking like a neuroendocrine tumour cell, and they're just nasty, aggressive things. The KI67 just puts a number on that, basically. It tells you what percentage of the cells are actually multiplying. The pathologists do a lot more, and they will be doing a lot more in the future. Increasingly, we're looking at genetic profiling of tumours, and I'm sure we're not far off a point where we'll have genomic analysis of every patient's tumour to look for specific targeted therapies. And that's a sort of rapidly expanding area of inquiry that's not quite at prime time, but close to it. So once you've got things like KI67, you can divide the tumours into low-grade tumours, where it's kind of not quite at the meh stage, but compatible with a totally normal life. The sort of middle-grade tumours, you've got to think about those. You really want to take those on and really sort them out. The high-grade tumours are aggressive, nasty, nasty diseases, difficult to distinguish from, you know, regular pancreas cancers. So it's worth thinking about this. Higher grade is more of a disincentive to doing an operation than higher stage. So surgery can deal with low-grade tumours that have spread. It's not so good at dealing with higher-grade tumours, even if they're localised. And that's where you need to be. That's where we need to be looking at chemotherapy agents and so on. And I think one of the most obvious characteristics of many neuroendocrine tumours is that they're functioning, they reflect their neuroendocrine origin, and many of them make tumours, or they make hormones rather. About 15% of pancreatic neuroendocrine tumours make hormones that cause clinical syndromes, and the common ones, insulinoma, gastrinoma. Clearly there's a big incentive to perform surgical procedures in those scenarios because you make a big difference to the symptoms that as a patient you will experience. It may be more difficult with the non-functioning tumours. If they're small and they're low grade, they really may not cause any trouble, and it may not be worth doing an operation in something that's not going to cause any symptoms. Maybe never cause any symptoms. Just very briefly, there are special situations, of course. I think the MUN1 patients are a very particular situation. There are other familial tumour syndromes, which maybe we don't need to get into right now, but the MEN ones are worthy of separate consideration. This picture is supposed to show you a pancreas with a number of pancreatic adenomas scattered throughout it. About 20 years, maybe 25 years ago, the mood was very much to treat these very aggressively and try to remove all the visible tumours. But as people have begun to understand the natural history of these small tumours, it's become clear that you don't have to be so aggressive surgically. So in general, the pendulum is swinging away from aggressive surgical treatment. And it's come from an understanding of how these small adenomas behave in the pancreas. Here's a chart showing change in size of a whole bunch of adenomas measured in a number of individuals over a couple of years. And you can see virtually all of them stay static. They don't increase in size. There's always one or two that are outliers. And the challenge, of course, is to identify those. And it may be that the sort of genetic signaturing may help to do that and avoid having to go through a process of surveillance where every time you have a scan you relive the initial diagnosis, and that can be very harrowing, I think. You can sort of see that the smaller the tumour, the lower the chances of secondary tumours occurring. So this is a bar graph shows you small tumours on the left, bigger tumours on the right. The grey boxes are the development of synchronous tumours, which is other tumours, and then the sort of lighter grey grey boxes are secondary tumours. So basically the message is with small tumours, the chances of getting a metastasis are very small, so it's reasonable to have a surveillance strategy in this scenario. So how do you pick an operation? Well, you've got to think about the general physiology of the patient. I think I'm about moment. Not quite at the walking stick stage, but it's out there. But you've got to have a consideration of that. And then you have to consider the biological personality of the tumour and try and find a balance between radicality of the operation, which necessarily or most likely will produce more of an impact of quality of life, versus functionality, maintaining those kind of characteristics. And I hope we've got to a point of shared decision making. I mean, I think the MDT helps the NET team pick the best option. Doesn't necessarily mean that's what the patient wants to do, what you want to do. It's a step in that direction. But I think as a patient, you have to be aware of the choices and the possibilities. And you need time to explore those preferences and make decisions about it. And then working out what matters most, I think, is terribly important. And it's important to understand that the surgeons and as patients, you have different perspectives. I think there's a real trap here, which I think has to be avoided, of having the pre-op discussion being basically a list of complications. It's horrible, I think, to have this kind of, you might die, you might have a leak, you might have a bleed, you might have a repeat operation, what do you want to do? It's a kind of essay in how not to do it, isn't it, really? Just coming back to this issue about what matters most, I had a moment of clarity. I can't say that without thinking of Samuel L. Jackson in Pulp Fiction, but anyway, moviegoers will know what I mean. I was at a conference on treatment of rectal cancer, completely different disease. And there was a discussion about treatment of patients with rectal cancer with preoperative chemotherapy and radiotherapy. Now, for a long time, people have recognized that sometimes the cancer goes and there's no residual tumor. The standard treatment has always been to take it out anyway. And with early rectal cancer, you can have very good five-year survival rates, 90%, and everything's wonderful. And from a surgeon's point of view, that's very clean, no messing, very attractive, if you like, because the surgeon's focused on survival more than almost anything else. But there is an alternative way. With chemoradiotherapy preoperatively, about 80% of patients whose tumours disappear will maintain their rectum. In about 20%, there's recurrence. And if you get a recurrence, it's a little less certain. There's probably a slightly higher chance of developing metastatic disease. And yet, patients are very keen on taking that approach. So the message for a surgeon is, lots of people are prepared to take a certain amount of risk to protect function. And I think it's very important that the surgeons understand that that's the way the patients think. It's also very important that the patients understand the surgeon thinks slightly differently. So we have to kind of meet somewhere in the middle, I think. I think it's also helpful just to think briefly about the differences in surgical treatment of pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors and pancreatic cancer. Because it's all a good news story. If you compare anything to pancreatic cancer, it's a good news story, of course. But of course, there's a greater emphasis on preservation of function because of the anticipated longer survival. And because of that, things like enucleation, so localized resections are far more acceptable. Now, interestingly, with the neuroendocrine tumors, you're much more likely to resect a bulky tumor to avoid local problems like obstruction of the gut or obstruction of the bile duct. Even if you're not taking it all out, the management of those problems without getting rid of the bulky tumor can be troublesome in the long term. So you can manage local complications far better by resecting the lesion if you can, even if you're not taking it all out. And of course, big difference. Patients with secondary disease in the liver, the common secondary disease, it can be well worth resecting those if it's technically feasible. And I think another interesting thing that's come into light now is it may be worth resecting or debulking tumours prior to considering PRRT for residual disease. We come back to this issue of the MDT trying to get the right sequence of treatments. And this is very much a kind of emerging area for the surgeons. But there seems to be sort of good data that if you can remove the primary net, it might actually help PRRT be more effective on the residual unresectable tumour. So I think we're sort of beginning to move in that direction a little bit. The graph basically shows the yellow line is patients these are groups of patients with PRRT. The patients with the yellow line had the big bulky tumour taken out first. The patients with the blue line just went straight to PRRT. Now, I think that's all I have to say. I would like to say thank you very much to Mark. It's been inspirational to interact with this group. I've learned an awful lot. And I wish you congratulations on the 10-year anniversary and wish you all well for the future.
So thanks so much to Justin. I think he really explained in layman's terms what is involved, and also very much like the idea that, you know, we, the patient, really have a role and input into the decision making of what happens. And, you know, we should all bear that in mind and put our views forward in those consultations. So I want to move on to the next speaker, which is Alan Wilson. So Alan is a paraganglioma patient, which is a rare form of NET. And he is also one of the founder of the FEO Para Alliance, which is a global organization on these diseases, paraganglioma, pheochromocytoma. So he's going to talk to us a little bit about these rare diseases.
Thank you, Mark. So can I ask you how many of you are pheochromocytoma or paraganglioma? It is a NET, but is anybody there? Put your hand up. One of us. Okay. Pheo or para? Para, metastatic? Okay. Well, we're very rare. We're like the tail on the dinosaur, let's say, if you guys are the dinosaur, or the tail on the zebra, if you guys are the zebra, or the zebra that swims. We're slightly different from most nets, and we're much, much rarer. So there wasn't much support whenever I started my journey. Around about 1994, we don't know for sure, because I was undiagnosed for quite some time, and the support network that you have now was not there. And you have the likes of Tommie, Mark, Dermot to really thank for delivering that to you, and also your collective efforts. So let's see if I can work this system up. Down. So it's a needle in a haystack trying to find people like myself or this gentleman in the audience. Our tumors grow as extra adrenal glands, or the adrenal glands themselves grow. The adrenal glands sit on the kidneys and they produce adrenaline, so you get a fight or flight response. This is to fight a tiger or run from a tiger. Our adrenal response is pretty well backgrounded. It just keeps on ramping up over time. That can result in strokes, hemorrhages, cardiac arrest, as well as the tumors of the cancer trying to eat you, as all cancers do, all tumors do. There are two distinct groups. There's pheochromocytoma, which is the bigger group. 90% of these are pheochromocytoma. They're the ones on the adrenal glands themselves. There's only 10% of those are metastatic. Most, you have surgery and it just disappears. It's fine, never returns. There's 10% go metastatic because it's been left too long or undiagnosed. 5-year survival, 95%. Paraganglioma is slightly different. 60% metastasize. It's outside of the adrenal gland. It can be anywhere. It can be in your brain. It can be in your liver. It can be, just like most NETs, anywhere that you want it to be or you don't want it to be. It's a diagnostic through blood or 24-hour urine tests, and they're measuring your hormonal response. There's about 2 metastatic paras per million per year. So in Ireland, there's probably 12 to 20 of us, let's say. Nobody knows for sure. We don't count, but very rare, as you can see, just judging by 1 out of 90 or 100 people in the room. It's a GP's dilemma because it's 1 in 10 to 20,000 hypertensive cases are pheopara, so they can test for this all their lives and they will never see it. So they actually, some of them don't believe it even exists. It does. I think probably 10 to 12 in the country at any one time. These are related syndromes, MEN2, VHL, FN1, which is, I'm not used to speaking, public speaking. Carney's dyad and triad, and then SDH, which is a subdivision of the paraganglioma itself. It's a particular type of genetic condition that there are defined outcomes and it accelerates. The disease is quite aggressive, and probably by 50s and 60s with SDHB, for instance, you can have significant problems. So I was 12 years pre-diagnosis, diagnosed in 2006. I diagnosed myself using Google, but I didn't believe it and the GP didn't believe it either. He said, rare than hen's teeth, don't be so stupid. Turned out to be Google was correct. Large primary along the sympathetic nerve chain that metastasized to the lung and the liver. It was wrapped around my renal artery, wrapped around my aorta, and trying to attach itself to my duodenum. So they're quite aggressive tumors, slow growing, like a lot of NETs. The symptoms are insomnia, overheating, perspiration, headaches, mood swings, anxiety, depression, palpitations, and that's a strange term, feelings of doom. Having experienced this myself, it's a profound feeling that nothing in the world will ever make you happy again. I can't really put it into words. It's not depression, it's just everything just feels bleh. And it's for a prolonged period of time, days or sometimes weeks, sometimes it's just for a couple of hours. I personally had 72 times the normal background level of adrenaline, so you can imagine fight or flight 7 or 8 times that, or as one of my doctors said, it was the equivalent of a charging bull elephant in a human. Not too sure whether that's a good thing or a bad thing. Often you get adrenal attacks, and my doctors thought they were anxiety attacks because I was in business and maybe I was just over anxious. But adrenal attacks are profound. They are, when there's an adrenal surge, either through activity or pressure on the tumor, you get a spike in the adrenaline, and the spike can be huge. It takes your blood pressure up incredibly. You get a pounding through the body, then a surge through your spine, explosive headache, projectile vomiting, fall over, go catatonic, and people wonder what's wrong. It's interesting. I had 6 or 7 of those events over the years. And in those days, there wasn't enough knowledge really to understand what was causing it. So, so I had surgery in 2007, quite long-winded surgery. They thought there'd be 4 hours, one person, abdominal, take everything out, cut out the tumor from the sympathetic nerve chain. Ended up with 2 arterial surgical teams and 2 general surgical teams. Simple reason being that it kept on spiking. Every time they touched the tumor, it spiked the adrenaline and tried to kill you. So the anaesthetist job is incredibly difficult there. They have to alpha block and suppress the adrenal response. Not as easy as it sounds whenever you're tracking it as they keep poking it. So 12 hours later and then intensive care. There was a recurrence in the liver in 2008 and they wanted to cut 70 to 80% of my liver out for a little tumor. So I learned of some experimental work being done in the NIH, National Institute of Health in Bethesda in Maryland, which is really Washington DC. It's their big research hospital. You get treated for free there, but it's a bit of an arduous process that they put you through. I had experimental MIBG, which is an iodine radioactive chemotherapy kind of thing, and radiofrequency ablation there, which finally killed that tumor, but intensive care again, because when they embolized the blood supply, the tumor got angry and it tried to kill me again. So we went down the route of doing the operation regardless, and it all worked out for the best. So blood pressure control is very, very important, and alpha blocking is very important. There's a drug called phenoxybenzamine, which isn't very nice. It cuts off all of the adrenal response, so everything just kind of relaxes and you take on a lot of water. I was on that for about a year. I'm stable. I'm described as a stable metastatic paraganglioma, sporadic. So there's no genetic sign that they know of yet. I've had tests for 42 different gene types that might be lending themselves to this cancer. But I haven't had a recurrence since 2009, which is very lucky, and I'm very glad. But I'm here really to tell you that there's a journey involved in this. Most of our tumors are slow growing. Generally, we've got good survivability. Pheos, 95% don't return. Paras, up to 60% do not return, unless SDHB. Earlier diagnosis and intervention, which is what we are doing now with the collective response that we have here. The work that Dermot has done with the ENETS clinics and making sure that there are 50-odd clinics throughout Europe that are specialists in treating NET cancers, and we have them here now as well. The work that Mark does with INCA, the International Neuroendocrine Cancer Alliance, Ireland punches above its weight, and we actually do have some very good outcomes now. We have an empowered and aware patient community, as demonstrated by you all being here. I mean, if you think about it, there's possibly 10% of the patients in Ireland, maybe 5-10% are sitting here in this audience, and that means you're engaged. And the longer you have the disease, the more you take control of it, the less fear there is involved. You have committed physicians. All of the gentlemen that you've heard speaking and the ladies you've heard speaking today are very committed towards your futures and outcomes. And when you compare that with the USA, there's maybe 7 centers in the USA for a similar kind of disease percentage or penetration. It speaks volumes, really. The welfare system does work. Where am I now? I'm disease-free, I'm stable, I'm grateful, appreciative, more empathetic, more aware. I find that whenever I walk out the door, even the rain makes me smile. I smell a rose. It's better smell. Everything tastes good. And you keep reminding yourself how lucky you are to be alive. And the last thing I would just say really is that one of the things that wasn't available whenever I was first on my journey, 10 years without proper diagnosis, 6 GPs that missed it. And on the day that they diagnosed me, they told me they needed me in the hospital immediately. They gave me 3 hours notice, and I said, well, I need 2 weeks. And they said, no, you don't understand. So we compromised on the next day. But the adrenaline spikes were so high at that time that I could have dropped dead at any stage. It was quite interesting. When you look back and you understand with retrospect, or you know, in hindsight, the profound place that you were in. But what I did learn in the National Institute of Health in America was that for rare disease, you go where rare is not rare. They treat it every day, and it's common. And that's why you have NET centers, folks. That's why it's such a boon for you to have the facilities that you have now in Ireland and the ones that are coming with PRRT. We didn't have PRRT. We didn't have gallium scans, identifying the tumors, where they were, their locations. It was kind of archaic compared to where we are now. So I think if you have to have a cancer, have a NET. It sounds crazy because you suffer from them, I know, but by the same token, the outcomes are so much better, and the trajectory is really good these days. So that's about it.
So thank you, Alan, for that and sharing with us your journey on that rare NET diseases. So now I want to ask Mary O'Brien to come up. So Mary and Eoin O'Leary are going to talk to us a little bit about the NET community in Ireland and you know, how things have changed. And so Mary and Eoin are on our committee. So up to you, Mary.
Hi everyone, my name is Mary O'Brien and I am a patient. This is my husband Eoin. We're both committee members of NET Patient Network, and we both run the Facebook group and the support page. I'm going to talk to you about why we set them up, and it all starts with my story, the short version. My own patient experience is that my tumours were found by accident. When I went to a CT scan for gallstones, the CT scans confirmed that I did have gallstones, but it all shows up multiple tumours in my lower right lung. After multiple other tests and scans, I was diagnosed with lung neuroendocrine cancer and cancerite syndrome in 2012. After having the symptoms for at least 15 years, unfortunately there was very information, support and help available to me when I was diagnosed, and I felt very alone and frightened. A year after having the major lung surgery, I attended the specialist who diagnosed me with lung neuroendocrine cancer, who told me that I was now cured and didn't need to attend the lung clinic anymore. Even though I was still experiencing carcinoid syndrome symptoms, which were showing up in tests as well, and he was prescribing the sandostatin, so he told me that there'd be no problem. I would still receive the high-tech prescription for the sandostatin. But as far as he was concerned, I was cured and I didn't need to come back to the lung clinic anymore. Over a year, the carcinoid symptoms increased and my blood pressure kept on rising and rising, and I had to go on blood pressure meds. My blood pressure was extremely high one day, and my GP was afraid to get a stroke, so she sent me to And on a Thursday in December 13 to the A&E. The doctor on call never heard about neuroendocrine cancer or carcinoid syndrome. He had to Google to find out information. He contacted the lung clinic, but they said that they wouldn't be able to see me in the clinic until Monday, and I was discharged from the A&E. On Sunday, the carcinoid syndrome symptoms became so bad that I went into carcinoid crisis, and Eoin had to ring an ambulance while he had missed the sandostatin shots, what we were advised to do by other groups to stop the carcinoid crisis. Because of the symptoms Eoin related to the ambulance service, a paramedic arrived before the ambulance to keep me monitored, and as my symptoms started to improve from the rescue shots. He explained to Eoin that based on my very high heart rate, very high blood pressure and very high temperature when he arrived, that what Eoin did probably saved my life. I ended up back in A&E. In A&E, the doctor called the oncologist and called. She was so shocked when she heard that the lung specialist hadn't referred me to Dr. Power, the NET specialist, who was based in the same hospital. I was admitted to the hospital for a few days. When I was discharged from the hospital, I was given an appointment to see Dr. Power in his clinic. Thankfully, Dr. Power took over for my care. He informed me on that November that there was, in 2014, that St. Vincent's Hospital would be having an outpatient day, and it would be great if I could attend. Eoin and I attended that next day, and I felt so relieved that I was able to receive valuable information, and it was so nice to be able to talk to other patients and their families, and no longer that we felt we were alone. Eoin was asked to join the Patients Network Committee first, but I was always asked to join, but I declined because my confidence was still very low from what I experienced and after all I had been through. Over the next year, I could see how much Eoin and the other committee members were working so hard to improve things for patients. So at the next year's committee, next Patients Day the following year, I volunteered to join the NET Patients Committee. Like most people, I had gone on the internet for information, and I found that there were a lot of neuroendocrine tumour support groups on Facebook, but they were all based for patients who were based in the USA or the UK. I also found that some Irish patients were joining these groups now, and they were looking for information and support available for Ireland. So there was nowhere for Irish patients to get the information needed in these support groups. So I decided that I thought that NET Patient Network could fill this need. I discussed this with Eoin first and he agreed with me. A Facebook page and a support group for the NET Patient Network would be a great idea. So I discussed this with my fellow NET Patient Committee members, and after a long discussion, they agreed with my proposal. Eoin set up the Facebook page and the support group. Thankfully, we found that their families found that the support group very helpful, and over the time, patients were able to advise, support, and help each other. I then thought it would be great for patients to have their Eoin private support group, as some patients contacted me to say that they might feel uncomfortable to discuss things on our main support group, where their family members, who are also members, could see what they were discussing. It made sense to me that patients would like to discuss things privately with other patients. I have told you my story because from my experience, a great way to help each other. We all have a story, we all have different experiences and slightly different journeys that we can now share and help on each other in their journey. This happens always in our Facebook groups. Sometimes people will write a message totally confused about something, and then somebody who has already experienced what they're experiencing now will post a reply. The positive effect that this has had on both people is enormous. The stress level of a person who has posted has lessened because they get some clarity, and the person who replied feels good that even though they're a patient, they have helped a fellow patient. I'll now pass you over to Eoin. Thank you very much.
I'm short. Okay, I'll just talk quickly about the Facebook group.
So we started out, I think we had 90 members in the first year once we started the group, that's 8 years ago. And we're up to 400 now. And the group is working exactly as we expected. It's become a support group, not just for people that have NETs, it's people that have NETs and their symptoms, what they do with the symptoms they're having, because they're living with NETs all the time. If they're traveling somewhere, how do they get there? How do they get the buses, trains, airport, etc.? We all have people who've been to these places and they all know, look, this is what you do. You go here, you go there. This is where the hotel is. This is how you get to the hospital. And you then start the physical journey of getting to the hospital or whatever much easier, much calmer, because you know what's going on. Where am I now? I need to stress that it's the members of the group is actually what makes the group so good. It's not just myself and Mary. We've set it up and we try and keep things flowing. But it's the other members coming in when they see a question being asked and they say, right, I know about this. So they jump in, they answer the question, and all of a sudden you've got someone who's been panicked. Now they know exactly what's going on because someone in the same place has actually answered the question. And they're a patient, not a medical person, so they can actually understand what they're saying as well, which is very handy. So just about our group, the main Facebook group is for everyone. So any patients, family members, carers, and that's just kind of general discussion. And as Mary said there, we set up a second group then that Mary's in because she's the patient. And it's purely for patients only. So if there's something you didn't say, want to discuss within family, whatever, that can be done inside in that group as well. And that's become very beneficial as well. Mary's getting very busy. In order to join the groups, I'm looking around and I recognize it's maybe 20, 30 people in here that are actually in the group, so there's a lot of people not in there. The easiest way to do it is if you go into Facebook and just type in Neuroendocrine Ireland, we'll pop up in the search right at the top because we kind of, over the time, we've realized that's the best way to go. We started off with carcinoid and that, but unfortunately, Neuroendocrine is more popular at the moment, so we've gone down that route. And that will get you just, you click on that, you can join. If you have any issues, email support and they'll sort it out. Or if you want to join kind of, and you're not sure what to do now, I'm around here now for until after the group is finishing that. Just come over to me and have a quick chat. So a big thank you to the Facebook group members. I know it's been recorded, so the rest of them will see it because they're actually who make the group. And I'm very, very thankful to them. Thank you.
So thanks very much, Eoin and Mary, and they do a great job on our social media and keeping everybody informed of what's going on and then helping each other. And, you know, it really is all about helping each other out. To add to that, though, you know, if you want to talk to somebody or get some, you know, just some supports about what you're going through, get in touch with us at info@netpatientnetwork.ie. And like, we'll get back to you and we'll try and get somebody who can talk to you and you can chat about your journey, what's happening, and you know, there's always patients who are encountering the same issues and the same problems, so they're there and willing to help you along the way. So I want to have a very quick presentation about INCA and what INCA does and how it helps us here in Ireland. Alan mentioned that in Ireland we're actually punching above our weight. Dermot O'Toole is a past president of ENES, European Neuroendocrine Tumor Society. Alan from Belfast set up the FIO Para Alliance. And currently I'm the president of INCA, the International Neuroendocrine Alliance, for a 2-year term. So I'll be there till 2024. And I just wanted to explain what is INCA. So INCA is we see ourselves as the global voice of NET patients. And there's 32 patient groups within INCA across 26 countries. And we're just one of them. And they're the logos of the organizations that are involved in INCA. So we, as NET Patient Network, we joined INCA in 2016. That was through me as the representative of NET Patient Network. I joined their membership committee in 2017. became a board member in 2018 and the treasurer in 2018 as well. And I have to say that was Alan was the previous treasurer and he basically dumped that on me. Thank you very much, Alan. And then I was elected president this year and will be serving a 2-year term. But we have a good influence in the activities of INCA and what they do. The vision is, it's worth saying, so it's a world where all patients, neuroendocrine cancer and genetic NET patients, get a timely diagnosis, optimal treatment, support and care, and then ultimately a cure. And in INCA, we're working along the lines of trying to make that happen. We have various committees. It's all voluntary work from the different organizations around the globe. There are 2 paid staff members, an executive director who is in Bulgaria, and a project officer also in Bulgaria. Actually, Teodora Kolarova spoke to us, I think, maybe 5 years ago. She's the executive director. So there's 3 pillars. One is about raising awareness. Second is about access to optimal treatment and care. And the third one is about research and really the patient voice in research and making sure that our voice as patients and our difficulties and desires are brought into play in the in designing of research. And then about advocacy, so advocating for a better world for us and better prognosis for us as we go forward. So I wanted to just highlight some of the things that INCA has found. One of the things is about information. So INCA has determined from surveys that the majority of patients feel they're not getting enough information from the clinics, from the clinicians, yet the clinicians feel they are giving enough information. And there's one real stark statistic that came out, I think, in 2017, that 86% of patients felt they didn't get enough information, and 86% of clinicians felt they were giving enough information. So really at opposite ends of the extreme. But also we've confirmed that it's an average of 5 years to diagnosis for a NET patient. It does vary across the globe, but on average 5 years, which is too long. And one of the objectives of INCA is to reduce the time to diagnosis and get that happening earlier. And even worse is that by the time a person receives diagnosis, they almost half, I think it was 42% and 41%, have stage 4 metastatic cancer by the time the diagnosis is received. And of course, that's not curable. It is treatable, but not curable. And we need to make sure that that doesn't happen, or that we can improve that. And the way to do that is through earlier diagnosis and awareness of the disease amongst the primary care physicians or general practitioners. We need them to know that this is potentially a NET. And for those of you who don't know the reason for why we have zebra stripes and why zebra is a symbol of rare disease, and in our case for neuroendocrine cancer, it's because clinicians are taught that if you have A, B, and C, then the reason for that is X. So if you hear hoofbeats, a physician will think it's a horse, but we're saying, well, it might not be, and that's why it might be a zebra, and that's what the stripes come from. So trying to get the clinicians to think out of the box, and what we really want is GPs, when they hear our symptoms of irritable bowel syndrome that they think, or we've got gastric problems or whatever it may be, the flushing, diarrhea, that they put on the question mark, an NET question mark, when referring us on to the consultants, so that maybe they can consider that maybe this person has a neuroendocrine tumor. So some of the INCA projects, NET Cancer Day on November 10th is actually a creation of INCA's. I think from around 2012 or 2013 that was started. So it's November 10th every year. And it really is a massive global project based across the globe of raising awareness about NETs on November 10th. And we're part of that here this weekend doing that. Surveys is one that, because of the access to patients across the globe and the different perspectives that they have, surveys is a great thing that INCA can do. And we did an unmet needs survey in 2017. And that produced that statistic that I mentioned of 86% of patients don't get enough information, 86% of clinicians feel they do give enough. We did a big survey and so many Irish patients replied to that. I think we had over 110 Irish patients responded, which was brilliant, in 2019. SCAN is the survey of challenges and access to treatments and diagnostics for NETs. So almost 2,500 patients across the globe replied, 436 physicians. from 68 countries and 6 continents. INCA has produced a series of net info packs. There's 20 different info sheets on different types of nets, and they're in 10 different languages. And they're available on the INCA website, so you know, you should really go online and download them. There's a lot of information there. We're actually redeveloping Net Patient Network's website at the moment, and thanks to Adrian and Eoin for leading on that. And that out of that has come our new logo here, which is like a heart shape with the zebra stripes inside. And we're developing a whole new website from scratch, and that will also link in with the INCA website. So this information that I talk about will be available on our website, but coming from the INCA one. INCA produced a newsletter to tell what's happening around the globe, and anybody can sign up for that. It's useful and worthwhile to know what's happening. There was a boot camp run in 2020 to 2021. And for that boot camp was about research and about training patients in how research happens. How do you read a research paper? What are primary endpoints and secondary endpoints? What, how statistics work? What you should be looking out for? There was 18 graduates from that. And the idea there is that we want to create a pool of patients who are comfortable to be on steering committees of research projects that can get involved. And patients can bring, and one of the big things is the language that's used, to make sure that the language on these research papers are more understandable to patients, and therefore more possible to recruit patients in the clinical trials. And also about the, you know, questioning the structure of the ongoing testing of patients. Do they need to be brought in this frequently? Do they need to have this kind of test? But we trained 18 people, and that's a pool of resource that we hope will get used from around the globe. And then publications. So everything that INCA does, we try to publish it. We had a paper on unmet needs published in 2017, and that's one of the most downloaded papers from in the field, giving information about patients. We're currently developing a journal article for SCAN. Hopefully get that published early next year. But we know that if we don't publish, then it doesn't get recognized. So the work that's done can get lost. And really, the clinicians will only take it on board if it's been published and they can refer to that, because the publication is always peer reviewed. So that's what we're trying to do. So that's some of the projects that INCA is working on. The findings that came out of SCAN, almost half of gastroenteropathic pancreatic NET patients diagnosed initially irritable bowel syndrome, gastritis, and even anxiety. The number of consultants that a patient has to go to before they get their diagnosis. So you see 22% see 4 or more, 23% are seeing 3 or more. And I'm sure that's true of many of you. I know it's true of me. And then the diagnosticians, so who actually diagnoses NET? So gastroenterologists is one of the big ones, but actually GPs was, from our survey, came out as 20%. And the ongoing management of that is 44% of GPs. So from that, we're doing the next big project for INCA, which is called Think NENS. And the tagline is easily missed. So this is an online program for GPs, which will have CME accreditation. And the idea here is that it's going to be hard to get the attention of general practitioners, because they're bombarded from all sides with all sorts of rare diseases, and everybody wants their rare disease to be recognized and to be understood by the GP. So we have a big task ahead to try to promote the course. The course will be ready probably in the latter half of next year, probably going into quarter three next year. We are working with WONCA, which is the World Society of General Practitioners. We have on board a consultant from WONCA who has a lot of contact to make sure that we can try to roll the course out. But we're going to need, on the local level, as in like in Ireland, in Sweden, in Germany, the local organisations there, of which we are obviously one in Ireland, to push the course amongst GPs in our territory. And really you, the patient, as well, to tell your GP that this course is there, and encourage them to do it, and for them to encourage their colleagues to do it. So next year we'll be talking about, you know, getting onto you to help push that course out into the world. that's really it. So you can see the, you can learn more information about INCA from the website, incaalliance.org, and our new website will integrate very well with that and give it access to a lot of that information. So with that, thank you very much. So I know we are slightly over time, but we will finish shortly. For the last thing, I want to ask Tommie Gorman, who conceived our organization back in the late noughties, early tens, and created our group. And Tommie has, he's published a book about his journey, not just with NETS and his career. And we've asked Tommie, can he stay around and sign books for people if they want it? So I think there's going to be a setup outside for books. So Tommie is willing after the event to sit down and sign books for people if they want. So Tommie.
Hello, everybody. Lovely to see you here. Just to let you know, there'll be a coffee break immediately afterwards, and as you're going out, you'll be asked by hotel staff about the main course. If you're staying for the lunch afterwards, there's a choice, so you might let them know what you'd like to have. First thing I want to say to you is it's such an honor to be here before our family. 150 people here, our biggest turnout, the hunger for knowledge, lots of new faces, and obviously post-COVID, the chance to actually engage with each other, and it's a lovely sight to see. And when I say it's an honor, that's entirely genuine. This is our family. If you have the disease, the condition, like a lot of us here have, that's a burden in itself, but sometimes I see it in a completely different way. We're the ones who have been given this, but it's a chance to say something about ourselves. I love that line, nothing survives but the way we live our lives. And this is our chance to actually define what we stand for, who we love, what we want to leave behind. And the decision has been made. We have the condition, we did nothing wrong, but we have it. And certainly I'd like to use this journey as my chance to leave something better in place for those who come after us. And I'd also like to let those who love me see that, you know, I rose to the challenge as best I could. When I speak of the family, I'm very conscious of those who love us, our spouses, our partners, our siblings, our children, our neighbours, our friends, and how difficult it is for them. It's more difficult for them in some ways than it is for us, because we'd actually prefer to take this thing on our shoulders ourselves rather than let them have it. They would like to swap positions with us. They worry about us at night. They worry when we're coming up to have our test done. And I think it's very important to be conscious of those people as we are on our journey. We're the ones wearing the number 9 jersey. We're the centre forward. We're the midfielders in Gaelic terms. We're the out half. We're the in rugby terms. We're the people taking that kick. But we also have to think of them. And when I talk about the family, this family would be no way complete if we didn't have this wonderful cooperative, this mehel, with the people who work in the medical profession. And I don't just mean the clinicians who are here. I mean the nurses. I mean the receptionists. I mean the HSE, with which we have the most beautiful relationship. So, so supportive. All we ever get from the HSE is kindness. The way they facilitate us in our need to travel abroad for procedures that aren't available here. The understanding to show on that, that is just something beautiful, and it's something life-enhancing in those dealings. Today in the room, again, we have a presence from the Irish Cancer Society. That's something very important as well. The reason why we're able to have this function, to have meals, to have a subsidised accommodation, is because we receive funding from the pharma companies. That's very important for us as well. So that's our family. You heard the director of the National Cancer Control Program, Ristéard, Kerry man, great man. So, so supportive of our organization. So that completes our circle, and that's why we are able to make progress. Now, when I talk about the clinicians, I want to draw attention to two people today, because it's a very special day in some respects. One is Justin Geoghegan. This will be his last NETS gathering as a full-time consultant attached to St. Vincent's Hospital. When you came in here today, if you hadn't met him in a white coat beforehand, you'd think he was one of us. He could have been somebody working in the hotel. He certainly doesn't have that sense of an officer. He is just so gorgeous in the way he deals with patients. That has been our experience of Justin throughout our time. Another thing about Justin is he has stayed with us, always there. And that is typical of the experience we have with all the consultants and all the people involved at every level. So I just want to mention Justin for that reason. I also want to talk about the next generation. There's somebody in this room that you're going to get to know an awful lot more about. That's Hussein Al-Miamar. This is the first consultant, full-time consultant NETS physician in the country. Recently appointed, very few of them in Europe. And when you talk about progress that is being made, this man sitting in the second row is evidence of how our organisation is developing. And that's wonderful. Looking at yourselves, and knowing the dilemmas and the questions that are facing us, and some of us are at different stages on the journey, I don't want you to have any sense that we are alone or that we are second class. When Justin made his presentation and you saw up there pictures of a pancreas, and sorry that the screen wasn't higher, we'll learn from that next year, it will be. But so often when you hear of a person having pancreatic cancer, you know the prognosis is so, so difficult. And I jump for joy when I hear a person has got a NETS primary on the pancreas, because the potential for staying alive for much longer, provided you get access to the right care, it just jumps dramatically. So that's one of the really special things about people here who've got a NETS primary in the pancreas. We live much longer than people who've got bog standard pancreatic cancer in most cases. And it's so, so uplifting to think that the care that's available to you in this country is better than what was available to Steve Jobs, one of the richest men in the world, when he was diagnosed with that very same condition. Second thing I wanted to say to you is in relation to PRRT, lutetium treatment. I think I was the first Irish person to get that treatment in Uppsala, but hundreds of us, I think, have gone since to Uppsala, or to Rotterdam, or in some cases to England. And very soon we're going to have that very same treatment here in Ireland, which is wonderful. But we were getting that through our HSE, through our network, through the consultants who recommended us. We were getting that before Americans, before Brazilians, before people. I used to meet people from Argentina in Uppsala. That's because it was approved in Europe before it was approved, say, in the United States. So in many respects, we're so ahead of the curve. To let you know how our organization works, You saw Mark making his presentation. Mark is our chairman. He's the leading person in our committee. He represents us internationally. He has grown into the job so much. He's a fantastic example for us. And it's no salary whatsoever, no allowances, no nothing. But what Mark does is he does the job out of dedication and out of love, and he's a wonderful chairman. You heard Mary and Eoin. They're our Cork presence, and they fly the flag for us in the south, but they also fly the flag for us on social media, and we're so grateful to them. And you saw the way they dovetailed in their presentation. And although Chris Darrell Sulawan and Derek Power, two great consultants, aren't here today because of other commitments, Mary and Eoin have flown that flag for Cork and for Munster in such a very, very effective way. And thank you for that. The other members of our committee, and I think they're wearing badges like this. Helen lives in Dublin. Helen is another member of our committee. Tom O'Donoghue is living in County Tipperary. Fantastic man. Met him first in Uppsala many years ago, and he and his wife are stalwarts, really great people. Very same as Helen. Adrian is a new recruit. Adrian is based in County Wexford, and he brings new energy to our committee. And then our West of Ireland presence, John Fallon, is down the back from County Mayo. I think he was the second patient to go to Uppsala all those years ago. And I'm based in Sligo. And we have two other committee members. Andrea has other commitments today, and Carmel is dealing with illness at the moment, but that's our committee. And we're recruiting for more members. So if you would like to think of yourself as a committee member, we could do with you, and you can talk to any member of our committee after this event. So a few final points to make to you. We've got work to do, and we intend to do it. Dermot O'Toole is the national lead of our organisation. And Donal O'Shea, you heard from, they work hand in glove together. They drive the organisation for us, based in Dublin at the Centre of Excellence. We want to develop PRRT treatment in Ireland so that people who would struggle to go to the other centres of excellence in, say, Sweden or Rotterdam or in the UK, that they will be able to receive that treatment in Ireland. And we want to build up the patients' numbers. And while we are doing that, there will always be a facility for people to go, while it's been done in Ireland, for people to go to those centres. It's the last remaining piece of the jigsaw. It's not going to be downgraded in any way, the right to travel. We're going to keep that while we build up the Dublin presence. Catherine from the HSE is 100% committed to that. But we have work to do there. Mark and my committee members know that we have also got work to do for our Cork patients in particular in relation to your travel arrangements for Rotterdam. We are going to work on that. We're going to get a solution to it, because we don't believe in any sense that there can be two classes of patients. We have to have fairness, equity, the very same good conditions for every patient in our organisation. We're also going to work in relation to gallium scanning, because it's such a working tool. That's another of our priorities. But in general terms, we're 10 years young today. We have got priorities for the next decade. And we intend, it was fascinating listening to Donal O'Shea saying how he has learned from us and how other patients' groups are now using our technique to lobby. We got to stay ahead of them. We got to be better than them. So we have to stay smarter. I don't want them catching up and being as good as us. We have to set our own standards. And that's what we intend to do. So with those few remarks, thank you for staying so engaged for so long. I know a lot of information has been thrown at you. There's a cup of tea or a cup of coffee available outside. There'll be a Q&A session after we have a number of questions when you come back. And again, from the bottom of my heart, it's lovely to see our growing family, including the new faces, the new members. Thank you very much.
So we break for a quick coffee break. If we can come back here by 5 to 12 at the very, very latest, please. And think about questions you'd like to ask. If you're not asking a question, listening to the other questions being asked is going to give you a lot of information as well.